You've finally reached the top of a hill and look forward to an easy descent. A road sign indicates the downslope angle ahead. Maybe this won't be so relaxing. How fast will you end up going? Should you brake on the way? Do you have to worry about your wheels overheating or a tire blowing out? Hi, we're Pam and Gilbert. In this video, we'll investigate the maximum speed you can expect to reach while going downhill and the most effective braking strategy to survive it. We'll start with a quick explanation of terminal velocity. This concept is most often applied to falling objects. As the Earth's gravity pulls downward and accelerates the descent of the object, the aerodynamic drag generated increases until both forces equalize and the object stops accelerating, reaching what's called terminal velocity. This speed is a function of the shape of the object, its weight, and the air density surrounding it. How does this apply to your Brompton? Well, as a bicycle coasts downhill, three major factors come into play. The gravity pulling toward the bottom of the hill. This force will increase depending on the total weight of the bicycle and the slope gradient. The tire rolling resistance, which is also dependent on the bicycle weight and the slope. In addition, it is affected by the type of tire and the pavement quality. And finally, the aerodynamic drag, which is a function of the bicycle speed and the aerodynamic properties of the bicycle and its rider. Like the falling objects we saw earlier, the bicycle will accelerate until the sum of all forces equalizes, at which point the speed will stabilize. Adding more weight to the bicycle should accelerate it. However, the increased drag caused by the frontal area of a tea bag or a large burrow bag will negate some of the speed gain. Expect a Brompton with such a setup to go faster than an unloaded Brompton only if it carries more than 20 kilograms of luggage. In all cases, a higher terminal velocity can be reached if the rider assumes a low head and shoulder position. Finally, the maximum speed reached will be dependent on air density. Everything else being equal, a downhill rider in Denver would go about 10% faster than a similar rider in Singapore due to the lower air density found at higher altitude. The expected terminal velocity as a function of slope gradient is as shown in this graph. For example, a 4.5% slope should provide around 40 kilometers per hour terminal velocity, as shown in this video from Victor of Everyday Cycling, filmed in Atlanta. More significant slopes are often found at higher altitude. For example, Ross and Laura from the Path Less Pedaled channel cycle down the Big Hole Pass in Montana. Located above 2,000 meters, it has an average gradient of 6.5% at the location where the video was filmed. Laura reached a speed of 55 kilometers per hour, while Ross, assuming a more aerodynamic position on his bicycle, went 20% faster, reaching 68 kilometers per hour. Now let's look at braking while going downhill. Assuming a 10% slope at low altitude, the predicted terminal velocity should be around 63 kilometers per hour. If you apply full brake force, the bicycle will be stationary at the top of the hill. Definitely a safe and secure position, but not much of a solution if you want to reach your destination. As you release the brakes by 5%, the speed will increase to 15 kilometers per hour, and the brake pad will generate 400 watts of heat. Releasing the brakes by 30% will increase the speed to 35 kilometers per hour, and the heat generated will peak over 600 watts, the equivalent of a small microwave or toaster. As the brakes are released further, the bicycle will eventually reach terminal velocity and no brake heat will be generated. As can be seen, maximum heat generation occurs between 20 and 50 kilometers per hour. To estimate how this affects rim temperature, we need to look closer at the difference between a Brompton and a full-size bike. This cross-section of a Brompton wheel shows the tire, inner tube, rim tape, and aluminum double-wall rim. Now let's compare it to a similarly priced full-size bike equipped with aluminum wheels. Not only is its diameter larger, providing more thermal absorption capability, but the rim cross-section is deeper and thus more aerodynamic. As the brakes are applied, the energy is mainly absorbed by the rim, the brake pads having much lower thermal conductivity than aluminum. The Brompton wheel, with its lower aluminum mass and thus smaller thermal capacity, will see its temperature increase faster than the larger wheel of its bigger cousin. Furthermore, convection cooling due to airflow around the wheel will be better on a full-size wheel due to its deeper rim and the lack of fenders. Using a mathematical model developed by David Wilson, referenced in the description, It's possible to roughly estimate the rim temperature during a steady state descent, assuming both wheels are used for braking. With no brake applied, the rim will be roughly at ambient temperature, or 20 degrees Celsius, and the bicycle will be going at 63 kilometers per hour. If we apply brakes to reduce the speed to 50 kilometers per hour, the rim temperature will increase to 55 degrees. Further deceleration at 35 kilometers per hour will increase rim temperature to 85 degrees. At 20 kilometers per hour, the rim will reach 100 degrees. For comparison purposes, the mathematical model predicts approximately 75 degrees for a 20-inch wheel bicycle and less than 50 degrees for a full-size road bike. Rim overheat during descent can therefore be a serious issue on a smaller wheel bicycle equipped with rim brakes like the Brompton. Ideally, and if road conditions permit, riders should avoid constant braking, instead braking intermittently in order to give the wheels a chance to cool off. But what exactly occurs if the rim reaches higher temperature? Unfortunately, there's no definitive temperature threshold at which we can predict failure. One thing that is easy to evaluate, however, is the expected tire pressure. Using the ideal gas law, assuming a 100 psi tire at 20 degrees Celsius, the pressure will be 127 psi at 100 degrees. As a rule of thumb, expect a change of 3 psi per 10 degrees Celsius. The combination of high temperature and high pressure increases the probability of tire failure. For example, tire patch adhesive could start melting, creating an air leak. Rim tape can melt, allowing a spoke to perforate the tire. In a more serious scenario, a poorly installed tire could eventually blow out as it is ejected from the rim. So, to sum up, a rider of average weight on a C-line bike should reach 45 kilometers per hour on a 5% slope, and in excess of 60 kilometers per hour on a 10% slope. A touring setup with a large front bag will increase this speed only if more than 20 kilograms is carried. And remember, your smaller wheels are prone to overheating during descent. Thus, our advice is, avoid constant braking. Use your riding position as a speed brake. Unzip your jacket, for example. When you really need to brake, use both front and rear wheel braking to equally distribute the thermal effect. And stop by the side of the road to cool off your rims if you suspect overheating. We'd like to hear your experience with maximum downhill speed. Let us know in the comments and include where you were and your bike setup.